Christine, won't you come and share with us?
I am tired of apathy. It's like a poison inside of me, always growing in the dark. I want the light back in my heart. I am tired of wandering, falling in love with lesser things. But it's time my running ends. Come remind me who I am. Give me a heart that beats brand new. Give me eyes that search for you. Every day, every step till my final breath. I wanna live like I've been born again. Like I've been born again. Won't you break what's hard as stone? Put compassion in my soul. Might take a miracle to do, but that's what I find when I come to you. Give me a heart that beats brand new. Give me eyes that search for you. Every day, every step till my final breath. I wanna live like I've been born again. Oh, like I've been born again. Cause the old life is gone and a new day is come. I've been born again. Like I've been born again. Oh, like I've been born again. Like I've been born again.
Can you hear me now? Hang on here. Takes me a minute to get this on. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you very much for bringing us all here safely. Father, you are great and wonderful, and you've created Alberta so that we really enjoy the summers, because we sure miss them in the winters. And thank you for the beautiful summer we've been enjoying. And thank you for bringing us here and giving us a chance to worship with like-minded people and a chance to fellowship with them. And I ask that the words of my lips be pleasing to your ears. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, when you hear the phrase born again, what comes to mind? What does the life of someone who look like who's been born again? You don't need to quote the exact scripture and verse, but throw something out here, people. You can't be asleep yet.
Change.
Change. All right. How about quoting some scriptures? Great peace have they that love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. Anything else? Come on, Tom. Volunteer, or you're going to be voluntold. Come on, something's got to come to mind, people. When you think of people who are born again, what comes to mind? Love each other as you love yourself, yes.
Refreshed.
Oh. Ooh, she's got the scripture. What does it say? Okay, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. Anybody else?
A new heart.
Noah.
Our identity
is in Jesus Christ. Yes. How about, by this everyone will know that you're my disciples if you love one another. Or God loves a cheerful giver. So how about they display the fruit of the Holy Spirit? Actually, at camp this year was kind of interesting because Smitty, we have a big sign up that said the fruits of the Holy Spirit. And he goes, that's wrong. He says, there is only one fruit of the Holy Spirit. I actually had to go look it up because I thought, what? But yeah, there is only one fruit. There's many components. You can't pick and choose which one you want. You have to have them all, right? Ephesians 4, verse 1 says, oh yeah, and then somebody went up and sliced the S off, so now it says fruit of the Spirit. So Ephesians 4, verse 1 says, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Followers of Jesus are people who do not just profess certain views, but apply their growing understanding to every aspect of their life. They actually follow Jesus. So the question now is, does your life look like you've been born again? Do you comfort others? Do you do good works? Are you forgiving? Are you growing in wisdom and faith? Do you give thanks continually? Do you love one another? Do you love your enemies and pray for them? Look back over the past year of your life, the past 5 years, the past 10 years. Can you honestly say that you have grown to be more like Christ? In the parable of the seeds and sower, there's a group that initially grew and then was choked by the weeds. Christians who no longer are growing and maturing. Apathetic, just going through the motions. Is your spiritual life on autopilot? It doesn't work. We need to learn and believe that sin is not just an occasional instance of moral failure on our part, like a mole or a tumor that we can have removed. I am the tumor. The cancer of sin has spread through my entire body and permeated every aspect of my soul. We can be nice on occasion, but our nature is one of corruption and sin. Psalm 51, verse 5 says, surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. It's like Disney's story of the Beauty and the Beast. He used to be a prince, handsome. His palace was pleasant, a nice place to live. Then the curse fell and he became a beast. The curse fell on us when Adam and Eve ate the fruit. We've been different since the curse. Beastly, ugly, defiant, angry. We need to face the fact that there is something beastly within each and every one of us. We do things we know we shouldn't do and wonder why we did them. Romans 7, verse 15 says, for what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. We want to gratify the cravings of our flesh. If the biggest sinner we know isn't ourselves, then you don't know yourself very well. The Bible is like prime time TV. It's full of ugly events. Rape, infanticide, adultery, lots of murder. Blood runs freely through the Bible. We are no better than the people in the Bible. We can do good occasionally. It's just that we can't keep from doing bad. And if you think you can do it... try to going 24 hours without any sin. No wrong thoughts, emotions, actions. Good luck. And if you think you did, you either locked yourself in your bedroom and slept for 24 hours, though the absence of sin doesn't equal doing good, or you don't have a good grasp of what God considers sin. So we like to compare ourselves to other humans so we feel good about ourselves. But the standard is God. Romans 3:23 says, we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. I mean, it's hard to believe that I'm that bad. After all,
I haven't stolen anything big. I haven't killed anyone. I only covet other people's stuff occasionally. I only have gossip about people who deserve it. I tithe faithfully. Yep, God's pretty lucky to have me in his church. With that kind of an attitude, we don't really need grace, do we? And we won't be bothered to change either. As long as we think we aren't that bad, grace will never seem that good. In our old life, we made decisions based on what was best for us and what we wanted. Being born again, your new life in Jesus affects what you believe, how you think, how you live, how you feel, what you want. Born again, we are led by the Holy Spirit according to our new lives in Christ, not our old lives in Adam. Being a child of God isn't about striking a good bargain with him. We have been at war with our Maker, and his terms of peace are complete and total surrender. All your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. Complete and total surrender. Have you really changed, or have you given your old sinful nature a coat of paint? Have we put on the mask of Christianity for so long we have deceived ourselves? A spirit-filled life is one in which our thoughts, feelings, emotions, insights, desires, and decisions, everything is influenced by and motivated by the Holy Spirit. Are you filled with the Holy Spirit, or are you filled with bitterness and resentment because there is someone you haven't forgiven? Are you filled with the Holy Spirit? Are you filled with yourself because of your looks, your wealth, your accomplishments? Are you filled with the Holy Spirit, or are you filled with the world, seeking gratification in physical things? Lots of people believe in Jesus without making the commitment to follow him. We want to be close enough to Jesus to get blessings, but not so close we might actually have to change. We want to follow Jesus without carrying our cross. To truly believe is to follow. Matthew 15, verse 8 says, "They know me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me." They knew the word of God, but never surrendered their hearts. The difference between knowledge and intimacy. Jesus said, "He is the way." If we are not consciously walking that way, we stray off the path. Pastor Bob talked about how Jesus would walk ahead of his disciples, and they followed him as a crowd. They were watching out for each other. Since they didn't have the Holy Spirit yet, they were probably not watching in a very loving way. But they noticed every time somebody stepped out of line and said, "Oh, look at that, Jesus." We are a crowd following Jesus badly. We get off the path, lose our bearing, stumble, fall. But we are in this together and should be supporting each other. Stop trying to do it alone. Christianity is not an individual pilgrimage. Maturing in Christ does not happen in isolation. It takes place in community, within the company of others who provide guidance and support during the journey. God was so in love with community that he wanted a world full of people to share with. We are supposed to reflect God's divine nature in our lives, and that is only possible when we move out of isolation into godly relationships with others. John 13, verse 35 says, "By this everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." The quality of relationships among Christians makes the church an effective witness for the gospel. Are you involved in each other's lives? Have we closed off our hearts to each other and dishonored God's intent? We are connected. What I do directly affects you. It's not that just if I'm rude to you, it hurts your feelings, but it also impacts the overall health of the church. My selfish behavior doesn't just slow my sanctification process, it inhibits my church's ability to minister to those in our community. It sets a bad example. Matthew 25, verse 40 says, "Whatever you did for the least of these, you did for me." How we treat others is how we treat Jesus. Do we gossip about others? Do we make others feel bad so we can feel good? When you're driving, do you speed up when you see someone that's trying to get in the lane ahead of you? Have we gotten into the habit of only praying for each other when we have problems or are sick. So I have a homework assignment for you. Look beside you, left, right, back, forward, look around. Here we go. And now pick five people who you are not related to. And I want you on Mondays to pray for one of them, Tuesday to pray for the second one, Wednesday, third, fourth, fifth, for 2 months. And I don't mean say, God bless Ken Harper and make him help him get him to his 72nd birthday. He had his birthday at camp this year. I mean, actually pray for them. Spend 5 minutes praying for them, asking God to bless their day. Maybe you're going to have to talk to these people and get to know the name of their kids, get to know something about them, but really pray an effective, fervent prayer. And if you're like me, you better write down their names because by the time you get home, you'll have forgotten them. So, I want you to do that for 2 months. So just out of curiosity, what was your action? Number one is that, wow, that's a good idea. I don't think I've ever prayed for that person. This is a good opportunity. Or number two, was it, what's the point? Nothing's really going to change, and I don't think I like that person anyway. Or number three, was it, who the hell does that woman think she is telling me what to do? Don't kid yourself. There were all those responses in this room. And your response is a good indicator of the state of your spiritual life. We are human. Our first reaction is to usually self-centered, right? How long does it take for a godly reaction to kick in? And then, which reaction do you follow? Every day we make choices that influence our thinking for better or worse. If we keep making the right decision, eventually a godly reaction will kick in first, and it's truly amazing when it does. Romans 12, verse 1 says, we are to offer ourselves as a living sacrifice. Why don't we? Are we afraid to give ourselves to God because of what he might expect from us? Are we afraid of what might happen? 1 John 4:18 says, perfect love casts out fear. Fear is a self-imposed prison that will keep you from becoming what God intends you to be. Are you afraid God will require you to give up your wealth? We brought nothing into this world, and we're taking nothing with when we go. Are you afraid of being shunned and exiled? The earth and all its fullness is God's. You can't be exiled from God. Are you afraid of death? Death is just the beginning. We will be with God. Did you ever take your kids swimming when they were young? And they're standing on the edge of the pool and you keep persuading them, come on, jump in, I'll catch you, trust me. How many people spend life on the edge of the pool without ever jumping in because they're afraid? They consult caution, ignoring faith. They prefer to take no risk rather than any risk. For fear of the worst, they never enjoy life at its best. Take the plunge, trust God. Are you tired of apathy? I looked up the definition of apathy. It says, lack of interest, enthusiasm, or concern, indifference. It's the absence or suppression of passion, emotion, or excitement, unresponsiveness. Behavior that shows that someone is unwilling to take action, especially over something important. An apathetic person may lack a sense of purpose, worth, or meaning in their life. They have no interest or concern for the emotional, social, physical, spiritual life of others and the world. Take the plunge, trust God. Pay whatever price it takes for an authentic walk with Jesus. What has it cost you lately? It's kind of interesting that Dr. DeCotch was talking about that. What has it cost you? What have you not given up? What are you not surrendering to Jesus? Only my will and my pride can hinder my enjoyment of God's love. Submitting my will to his may not always be easy, but remembering the misery of doing things my way certainly makes it easier. Jesus' last command to his disciples in Matthew 28, verse 19 was, go out into all nations and be perfect. No, it wasn't. It was to go out into the nations and make disciples. Our identity as God's children isn't one of perfection, but a picture of God's grace. We are never going to be perfect, but if we are maturing on the inside, it will show on the outside. The last few sermons, Pastor Bob has been talking about the parables of the kingdom of God and how it is already on earth within us. Being born again means we have committed our lives to being the people God uses to build his kingdom and express his will in every area of our life. We are on a journey to redeem the world for God's glory, one word at a time, one step at a time, one decision at a time. Deciding to do the right thing time and time again is an essential part of our love for God. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 31 says, "Whatever you do, do all to the glory of God." God is glorified through our spoken praise and worship. He is glorified through our integrity, honesty, diligence, humility, purity, and faithfulness. He is glorified by our being good spouses, parents, employees, and good stewards of our resources. Are you the most trusted, solid employee at the company you work for? Why not? Being born again means that you react differently to situations, not like everyone else in the world. We remain positive in a negative world. Unfortunately, Christians are known for being judgmental and condemning, right? Why is that? We're no better than people in the world. We just finally made a right decision and decided to follow Jesus. And why do we expect people in the world to live up to God's standards? They are not Christians. You can't expect them to act like Christians. But you're supposed to be showing them that there is a better way to live. I'd like to leave with a couple of quotes. The first one says, "Christ has no body now on earth but yours. Yours are the only hands with which he can do his work. Yours are the only feet with which he can go about the world. Yours are the only eyes through which his compassion can shine forth upon a troubled world. Christ has no body on earth but yours." That's from Teresa of Avila. She lived in the 1500s, and it's still true 400 years later. The second quote is actually from an actor. Has anybody heard of Zachary Levi? Remember a TV show about 5-6 years ago called Chuck? No? Okay. Anyways, I only watched it a few years ago because we got Netflix. But anyways, there was something different about this actor, so I finally Googled him, and he was a Christian. And here are some quotes. "There are a lot of people who consider themselves spiritual, but that can mean a lot of things to a lot of people. I don't really talk about it that often because there's too much talk in the world, especially with Christians. There's more proselytizing than there is actual living proof, and that's kind of sad. My job on the set, I believe, is to first just love people and gain that trust with people where they know that I really do love them and care about their well-being, so that when they are running into problems, they will hopefully at some point come to me and ask, 'What is your peace all about? What is your comfort all about? Where do you get your love? Where do you get your talents?' And I can turn to them and say without blinking, 'Jesus Christ.'" Living born again is demonstrating that through the Holy Spirit, change is possible. We are to be actual living proof that there is a God. When people look at you, do they say, "I want what you have"? Let's pray. Father, you are so awesome and so amazing, and yet you want us to be your friend, Father. You desire a close relationship with you, and you are constantly waiting for us to turn back to you. And it's like we sang in the song, "Who am I that the God of all the earth would knows my name?" And Father, help us to make the right decisions, to draw close to you, to choose you above all else, Father, to choose what is best, not just the good things. We ask for your blessing on all of us as we go forth and do our homework, and help us to grow as a church in love and consideration for each other and to be a shining example to this world. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'll invite you to stand.